Our friends in blue showed up at my garage in the form of two policemen in a patrol car. I watched them surreptitiously from my seat under the elevator. It was unusual to see such happy policemen. Their faces became more serious as they approached me. They confirmed my identity and said they had some bad news for me. Something had happened to my wife in our house, and she was in the hospital, but they couldn't go into details. I tried to leave right away, but they stopped me wanting some answers. Can you explain where you have been for the last 3 hours, sir? Yes, officer, I've been here all day. Just ask my two mechanics. Sorry. I did slip away for 10 minutes around 11 a.m. to get us some coffee. One of the cops came over to chat with Mike and Pete. The other one wrote down which coffee shop I was at. Can you show me your car, sir? He asked. Sure, my truck is outside. I took it outside to my pride and joy. The thorough bastard swept the interior, then opened the hood and groped the engine. Cold as a rock. That's it, sir. You can go to the hospital. There was a look of concern on my face as the hospital employee explained the extent of Kate's injuries, the fact that she had received a blood transfusion, and then informed me that she was now undergoing surgery. I thought it was very unprofessional of the doctor to half-smile the whole time he was talking to me. On my way out of the hospital, I was intercepted by the same two police officers who had been in the garage earlier. They wanted some more answers. We retired to the hospital cafeteria for some much-needed coffee. They wanted to know how my relationship with my wife had turned out. I explained that we met and married relatively late, 8 years ago. Kate was a successful attorney at a large local firm. She wanted children in principle, but resisted my pressure until she was almost 40, as she wanted to establish herself in her job. They asked me why she was home on a weekday. I explained that Kate had quit her job a month ago to take a vacation before her pregnancy, that kind of vacation before at least 10 years of domestic service. I then added in closing that I love my wife, and we are doing well and looking forward to doing the baby. They asked me if I knew a certain John Burton. When I said no and asked why they were asking, they dodged the question and walked away. I knew I could rely on my boys to lock up the garage, so I went straight home. There were two CSIs and one detective prowling around the house. The detective introduced himself and explained what he knew. He then asked me the same questions as the previous officers, plus one new one. Can you explain why we found several drops of blood in the first floor restroom, sir? I'm sorry, I have no idea, detective. Now, can I ask you something? It's obvious that you're not treating this as an accident, and that I'm being treated as a suspect. Can you assure me that you're not focusing on me as the only subject, but that you're also looking for the real culprit? You can rest assured, sir. We have several lines of inquiry. My colleague is talking to Mrs. Barton right now. Who is this John Burton I keep hearing about? I'm sorry, sir. I don't think it's appropriate for me to comment. Then he and the forensics team left, leaving me confused. I went upstairs to the master bedroom and looked at the scene of carnage. I would have been truly shocked had I watched for the first time. Earlier that day, around 10 a.m. at work, I started thinking about sex. There's nothing unusual about that. They say that guys think about sex an average of 67 times per waking hour. Let me tell you, men who have been effectively cut off from their wives for a month can at least double that. Since Kate quit her job, hour two, three times a week has dropped to practically zero. Kate was either out of sorts, bored with work and depressed, or too tired. Personally, I thought it was because her routine was pretty much over, and she was just plain scared. Being the caring husband that I am, I didn't want to put pressure on her. She would come out of her fear at her own pace. I knew my life would change after having children, but I realized her life would be turned upside down. I kept dreaming of what our sex life had been like in the early years of our marriage. Anywhere, anytime, anyhow. We made an effort to keep it fresh and new for as long as our imaginations kept going, and then slowly fell into the automatic mode that two long-term partners often fall into. I snapped out of my daze. I knew what to do. Bring back the spontaneity. Go home right now and beat Kate senseless. Okay, decision made. time to clean up and go home. I told Mick and Pete I was going away for a while. Pete asked if I could take the car he had just finished servicing for a test drive. When I got home, I was disappointed to see an unfamiliar car in the driveway. Heck, a visit from a friend had derailed my plans. I decided to go in anyway. Maybe the friend could be persuaded to leave and my plans could be saved. Without any suspicion or attempt to hide, I opened the front door. My fur immediately stood up and I realized that my marriage was over. The distinct sounds of enthusiastic sexual activity literally rattled down the stairs. It was almost a reflex action to pull out my phone and start recording video. Whenever a customer delivered a car to the garage, I always did a quick video recording so we wouldn't be accused of scratching it. With my heart pounding frantically, I ran up the stairs and peeked through the bedroom door with my video camera at the ready. Yes, it was Kate. And yes, it was some guy I didn't recognize. Happily having her on our bed, fighting the urge to pounce and kill, I turned away. I could honestly say it was the hardest thing I'd ever done in my life. My legs no longer held me up, and I collapsed to the floor just outside the door. Completely devastated, I was only vaguely aware that they were reaching their peaks right around the corner. I don't know how long I stayed there, but it gradually dawned on me that all sounds of their adulation had stopped and only talking could be heard. It was just as bad and still tormented me to the core. I knew I had to get out of earshot to gain time to think. I knew instinctively that any reaction I had based on emotion would lead to at least him ending up in the hospital and me ending up in jail. I needed time to think. I quietly got up off the floor, tiptoed downstairs, and collapsed onto the couch. Away from the sights, smells, and most of the sounds of betrayal, I was free of emotional distractions. I did what I did best and came up with a plan. Get him out of the room and out of sight. Beat the shit out of him where there wouldn't be too many bruises. His stomach should be just fine. Then throw him naked out the back door. Go back for her and throw her naked out the door. That should give them the right impression and give me complete freedom. With no bruises and no witnesses, hopefully I can avoid a trial. Fortunately, I had the perfect shock weapon in my workshop. 2 years ago, I was in the Army Reserve, National Guard, where my skills got me an assignment to clear the trucks we used to return to base. That's where I found a small device that was now going to come in handy. The police call them flashbang grenades. Slightly larger than a regular grenade, they are basically a small canister with a lever pin ignition mechanism. They were specifically made for hostage rescue and were designed to cause little physical damage so that they could be thrown into a room full of innocent people without any significant harm. However, the explosion is accompanied by an 8 million candle power flash and a 170 decibel impact sound. The flash alone can stun a person to the extreme for at least 5 seconds. My mind, driven by my newly acquired hatred, quickly formed the rest of the plan. I didn't want to mess up my house, so I couldn't just throw the grenade on the floor. I pulled out the device and quickly taped a short piece of rope to it, then put a noose on the end of the rope. Having prepared myself in this way, I tiptoed upstairs. As I got closer, I realized that stealth was again unnecessary. I could clearly hear male moans coming from behind the bedroom door. Stopping only to pick up my phone from the floor behind the door where I'd dropped it, I looked around the door jamb. Clearly ready for round two, the guy was standing at the foot of the bed facing the door. Kate was kneeling with her back to me. Her head bobbed lazily back and forth. Damn, she was good at this. I tried desperately to separate what I was seeing from any emotions I was feeling, but it was only partially successful. Looking out from around the corner again, I made sure his eyes were tightly closed. This time I noticed that he placed his hands on her head. Mentally rehearsing the sequence of events I had decided on, I took a deep breath and sprang into action. One step into the room, looped the end of the rope around the hook on the bottom of the light fixture, leaving the device hanging halfway to the floor. Pulling out the pin, slipping it into my pocket, heading out the door again, fingers firmly clamped over my ears and eyes squeezed tightly shut. Even with my precautions, the effect was amazing. I could clearly feel the shockwave and the bright reflected light through my eyelids. Following the plan, I leapt into the room again, ready for action. This time, it was my turn to be surprised. I don't know exactly what I expected to see, but it was nothing like the scene that appeared before me. Mr. Anonymous was lying on his back on the bed, blood gushing from his groin. Either nature had been extremely unkind to him, or something was missing. Kate was lying on her back on the floor with empty eyes, her mouth open and closed like a fish out of water, her face drenched in blood. Confused, I went out into the hall again to think. My musings were soon disturbed by two ungodly shrieks from the bedroom, accompanied by various thumps and slamming doors. I began to realize that I was in deep shit. My plan had failed. I looked out from behind the door jamb once more at the scene of carnage. The guy rolled off the bed and curled up on the floor, holding his groin, squealing like a banshee. Do you know how many nerves are in a penis? Kate was nowhere to be seen, but a blood trail led to the bathroom. We need to clean up the evidence. I went back into the room, looked around, and quickly found the detonator mechanism from the device, adding it to the rope. I couldn't find anything else, so I concluded that everything else had been destroyed. I headed for the bathroom, very careful not to step in the blood. Kate was on her knees, vomiting into the toilet bowl. I had no desire to go and help her. I just didn't care anymore. On my way to the door, I noticed something among the blood on the floor. I picked up a piece of flesh. It was warm and soft, and resembled the tip of a tongue. On my way to the front door, I went into the first floor restroom and flushed it. They wouldn't sew it back on. Trying not to squeal my tires, I rushed down the street, once again glad we lived so far from the neighboring houses. Halfway to the garage, I emptied my pockets into a roadside dumpster. 10 minutes later, I was back in the little garage I called work. I called out to Pete and Mike, two dirty, oil-stained guys I call my co-workers and friends. They hurried over to me, seeing that I was alarmed. Guys, I need you to be my alibi for the last 45 minutes. What do you say?
Sure thing, boss.
It sounded almost simultaneous.
Well, before you so hastily agree, I have to tell you that what I did is pretty damn serious, and once I explain to you what it is, you might not be so quick to respond. I don't know what I'll be charged with, but it could mean jail time. Before I explained this to them, I went into my office and threw on some dirty old overalls. Then I walked over to the trash can and grabbed an oily rag, rubbing it on my face and hands. I didn't know when the police would show up here, but I expected them. The guys looked at me a little stunned. I briefly told them about the recent events. Mike broke first. He tried to hold it together for a good 15 seconds and then burst out laughing. That broke the ice for Pete, who soon joined Mike and me in uncontrollable hooting. It was a full 5 minutes before we all regained control, and with handshakes and pledges of support, they returned to their oily engine compartments. For the next hour, spontaneous laughter came from various dirty rooms. My wife Kate was about to reap the rewards she deserved for keeping aloof from my humble friends in the past. Do you know how hard it is to clean up blood? The bastardized stuff sticks to the blanket like shit. I was just scrubbing the bathroom floor that night. I decided to just throw out the bedding and made a mental note to buy a new rug for the bedroom. The tattered curtains would have to go too. I tried to keep busy by avoiding thinking. This process was not helped by the constant phone calls and knocking on the door. Yes, the media was in feeding frenzy mode. The combination of adultery and a guy getting his manhood bitten off was a story sent to them from heaven. I only opened the door once and soon disconnected the phone. Finally, with nothing to distract me, I did some self-digging. Do I regret what I did? Strangely, no. I hated cheaters with a passion. I'd seen too many guys turned into broads when they caught their partners. The funny thing is, even before lunch, I was willing to bet my life that my wife shared this passion. I was stunned that I was so wrong. Not to mention being completely stunned by Kate's motivation. She seemed to be as committed to me as I was to her, and our sex life was just fine. Well, until recently it had been. After hours of inner turmoil, I could only find one single clue. I remembered how the hair on the back of my neck stood up 2 months ago when Kate announced she was resigning to enjoy her last days of freedom. I had expected her to work until at least the 7th month of her pregnancy. Something about her saying she wanted a last hurrah before having children struck me as odd. My musings were interrupted by the ringing of a personal cell phone. Few people knew the number. Caller ID showed it was the number of Kate's parents. They lived in the same state, but about 3 hours away. I've always gotten along fantastically with them. So I answered. After a lot less of the usual pleasantries, her mom cut to the chase.
Dave, what's going on? Do you know why a bunch of journalists are besieging our house?
Well, they'll have to find out someday. I just couldn't bring myself to go into detail.
Mom, did you watch the local news tonight, maybe the lead story?
What, some cheater who bit her lover's dick off? I've always loved her mom's colorful language and her outlook on life, but damn, it wasn't making our conversation easy.
Yeah, Mom.
Look, there's no easy way to say this, so I'll start straight. The woman's name is Kate. Thankfully, my confusion was interrupted by a shout, followed by a beep. As I hit the disconnect button on my phone, I noticed a warning on the screen. It reminded me that I had recorded the end of my marriage just 8 hours ago. I had vague memories of leaving my phone on the recording outside my bedroom door. I knew that if I never found out and believed the reason Kate did what she did, I would never be able to trust any woman again. There was a good chance I'd die a lonely misogynist doomed to a life of uselessness. With desperate hope, I started the video playing. I already knew what it was showing. Kate, with her head on the pillow, ass in the air, being worked from behind. The pain was too fresh to relive the scene again. I opened my eyes just as I put the phone down on the floor. Without a visual, just a view of the hall ceiling, I had to imagine Mr. and Mrs. Adulter lying side by side on the bed. I couldn't make out the audio clearly, so I downloaded the file to my computer and ran it through an amplifier. This is an important part of their conversation.
Wow, Kate, that was fantastic. In fact, the last week has been great. Does it really have to end today? My offer still stands. Just give me the word, and I'll divorce Sarah and marry you.
Yeah, like that's gonna work. Great start to a marriage to a guy who fucked his wife and kids.
No, and I love Dave too much to hurt him like that.
Besides, he's a great husband and would make a good father. After today, I'll be Mrs. Goody-Goody Housewife. At least until the youngest of our children goes to school.
You can't love him that much. He's not the one lying here.
No, you're wrong. I love him very much. The moment I met him, I knew he was my only soulmate. I'll never meet another. We are so in tune sexually that he can take me where no one else has ever taken me. I am blessed to have such a good man who spoils me and will babysit me when I get a big belly from his 2 or 3 babies. No, I want nothing so much as to die in his arms, surrounded by our grandchildren.
Well, that was a great speech.
At least Kate had the humanity to think about it. There was silence for a good half a minute. I guess I just missed the past. I didn't get married until I was 31, and I was a bit of a wild girl. I miss just walking into a bar and getting punched by all sorts of guys. The thrill of leading a guy on and then impulsively deciding if he's going to score or not. Lately, every other weekend, Dave has been going deer hunting with his buddies. 3 weekends ago, I decided to take a trip down memory lane and check out a bar. That led to one night that was kind of okay, but unsatisfying. Then last Saturday, I happened to stop by the bar you were at, and here we are.
God, you're cold, Kate. Just consider this your last hurrah. Anyway, what are you complaining about, Mr. Big Buddy?
Come here. I said it has to end tonight. I didn't say it has to end right now. I turned the sound off. At least now I knew I was a good lover and husband. I wasn't the problem. The next few days passed in utter frustration. After 2 days, the reporters demobilized and left my quiet street. I received a call from the hospital administrator informing me that Kate would like pajamas. This I let slip past my ears. Uwe would have to put up with those humiliating hospital gowns. 2 days later, I got a call from her father. He apologized for his daughter's behavior and hoped I would keep in touch with him. To try to sweeten the deal,
He reminded me that he had another daughter, and she was recently divorced. Sorry, Dad, that's just too weird. 4 days after the event, he was back on the news. Mr. Not-So-Big Dick was released from the hospital. The reporters had done some digging and exposed him as a serial cheater. So they announced with some pleasure that although the surgeons had managed to sew his manhood back on, it was very unlikely that it would achieve even one of its intended functions. At the end of that week, I received an unexpected visitor. Mrs. Barton, or Sarah as she insisted I call her, was a lovely lady with sad eyes. She told me that rumors had reached her that I might have some evidence that might help her in her divorce case. I explained that maybe I did, but that I couldn't admit it without exposing myself. She understood and was very apologetic for asking. I told her that I thought there was such an overabundance of circumstantial evidence that she wouldn't need what I had. If that turned out to be wrong, I would talk her into coming back and maybe change her mind. There was such sadness in her that I felt sorry for her. Pulling out the video file, I scrolled her through just the aftermath of the Big Bang. The shock of her husband's screams made her cringe at first, but she soon pulled herself together. Suffice it to say, she wasn't too sad to leave. Being the helpful guy I am, I invited her to come over when the sadness returned to pick me up. Oh yeah, that wasn't the last time I saw Sarah Barton. The last visitor I received was probably the strangest. On Saturday, I opened the door to a detective I had talked to at the house on the day of the big event. The suit was gone. All that was left was jeans and a shirt. "Hey, son. No, I'm not coming in. I just wanted to say that with insufficient evidence, I recommended closing the case." Hearing my thanks, he turned to leave, but stopped and looked back. "Look, I'm retiring at the end of the year. If I come after that, will you tell me how you did it?" I just smiled and wished him a good day. The letter from Kate came the following Tuesday. "My dear Dave, I can't tell you how ashamed and sorry I am for doing this to you. I understand perfectly why you couldn't bring yourself to visit me, and I forgive you unconditionally. I never thought about the full extent of the possible consequences of my actions. I certainly did not envision that my parents would actually disown me. I know that I've lost your love, trust, and respect forever, which hurts me more than I can describe. I understand if you never want to talk to me again, but it might help your recovery if you let me explain why I did what I did. Just be sure it's all my fault. The doctors say I won't be able to speak properly for a long time, if ever. They think I swallowed the tip of my tongue when I bit it off. They are telling me about some experimental stretching technique that may restore some function. I hope it works, and I can at least get back to my career to take my mind off the dismal, love-deprived, childless future I'm facing now. Ask for anything in the divorce, and I'll sign it. If you find it in your heart to keep me on your health insurance for the near future, I would be eternally grateful. Goodbye, my love. I wish you nothing but happiness in the future. I hope I haven't completely messed up your life. Your Kate, aka your cheating wife." I have to say, the letter touched me, so much so that I immediately reversed my previous decision and sent her pajamas to the hospital. Now, where are Mick and Pete's cell phones? Do I owe them a beer? A keg each.
Thanks for hanging out and listening. If you liked the story, hit that subscribe button and give us a thumbs up. Make sure to check out our other wild tales right here on the end screen. Catch you in the next story.